A very good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ.
Good morning.
Welcome you all to Good Samaritan Church English morning service. And we especially want to welcome those worshiping online. My heart is steadfast, O God. I will sing and make music with all my soul. Awake, harp and lyre. I will awaken the dawn. I will praise you, O Lord, among the nations. I will sing of you among the peoples. For great is your love, higher than the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens, and let your glory be over the earth. Thus echoes the heart of the psalmist in Psalms 108. With the posture of the psalmist, let us now come together this morning to worship the Lord our God, who is our refuge, our fortress, our ever-present help. For by his strength we can overcome. With his love and compassion, he carries us through the rough and difficult terrains of life. I now invite you all to stand. Brothers and sisters in Christ, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
I was glad when they said unto me,
let us go to the house of the Lord.
Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord.
Let us shout for joy to the mighty Savior.
God is spirit.
We must worship in spirit and in truth.
Glory to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Praise the Lord now and forever. Amen.
The collect for purity. Let us pray. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Gloria, glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us now lift our voices and praise unto the Lord.
all sickness.
Above all sickness, above all fear, above every heartache in earth and heaven, my God reigns.
That's above all power.
Above all power, above all hope, the greatest love I've ever known. Today, forever, my God reigns.
Sing it again, above all sickness.
Darkest moment in trust in you to storm and raging sea. You're faithful, you're my God. You're the glory and the lifter of my head. Your light fills my days. It leads me in your ways. Forever I surrender all to you.
And every one of us, that we may be refreshed, that we may be strengthened, that we may be renewed, in Jesus' name. Amen. The collect for today, let us pray. Lord of all power and might, the author and giver of all good things, graft in our hearts the love of your name, increase in us true religion, nourish us in all goodness, and of your great mercy, keep us in the same. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of the scripture.
This morning's first reading is taken from Romans chapter 12, verses 14 to 21. Romans chapter 12, verses 14 to 21. Verse 14. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everybody. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my friends, But leave room for God's wrath, for it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let us all stand for the gospel reading.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke chapter 6, verses 27 to 36.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus.
Luke chapter 6, verses 27 to 36. Verse 27, love for enemies. But I tell you who hear me, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who mistreat you. If someone strikes you on one cheek, turn to him the other also. If someone takes your cloak, do not stop him from taking your tunic. Give to everyone who asks you, and if anyone takes what belongs to you, do not demand it back. Do to others as you would have them do to you. If you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who are good to you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners do that. And if you lend to those from whom you expect repayment, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners, expecting to be repaid in full. But love your enemies, do good to them, and lend to them without expecting to get anything back. Then your reward will be great, and you will be sons of the Most High, because He is kind to the ungrateful and wicked. Be merciful, just as your Father is merciful. This is the Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus.
Please be seated, brothers and sisters. That was the last part of the book of Romans in this video clip.
Remember the big picture. Because of their faith in Jesus, Jews and Gentiles are now together, Abraham's family, that new humanity that's being transformed by God's Spirit. And so, this is how God's fulfilling His ancient promises. Therefore, the only reasonable response is for these Jews and non-Jewish Christians to be unified as the church. In chapters 12 to 13, he shows that this unity will come from a commitment to love and forgive each other. Love will look like everybody using their diverse gifts and talents to serve one another in the church. And it will also mean humility and forgiveness. When these different ethnic groups and cultures come together in Jesus, conflict is inevitable, and it can only be overcome through the hard work of forgiveness and reconciliation. This is how they will show the greatest of Christian virtues, love, which fulfills the Torah's greatest commands to love God and love your neighbor as yourself. In chapters 14 and 15, he focuses specifically on the issues that are creating ethnic divisions in the Roman church. These are disputes about the Jewish food laws and the Sabbath. And Paul says these practices don't define who's in or out of Jesus' family. And if people differ over these culturally important but non-essential issues, they need to learn how to respect each other's differences. And it's in this way that love will heal and unify Jesus' family. Paul closes the letter by first commending Phoebe, who's a key leader in the church of Cenchreae. She had the honor of carrying and perhaps even reading this letter aloud to the Roman churches for the first time. Paul then concludes by greeting all the people that he hasn't seen for a long time, and that's the end. Whoa. You can see better now how all the pieces of this letter fit together and show what a profound masterpiece it truly is. That's what the letter to the Romans is all about.
Father, we thank you for the book of Romans. Thank you for your word. Lord, we pray that you will continue to help us through your Holy Spirit to guide us as we go into the other sections about having a new life in Christ. Help us, O Lord, to learn from all these practical ways of not just dealing with ourselves, but also to establish the relationship with God and also with one another, even to our enemies. Lord, we commit the rest of the time into your hand. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, we come to this last part, the last sections of this book. As you separate it, if you separate it like what the video clip had done to all of us, surely we know from chapter 1 to chapter 11, it's all about all those doctrinal issues and also theological teaching and about salvation. Okay? We have, I believe, those who were in the DT group, you have some big discussions among yourself about justification by faith. Even though we learned it and listened to it so many times, we still ask, is it that easy? What is really mean by justification by faith? How about sanctification? How about this and that? About righteousness and so on. But at the end, we all know, with the way that Paul put it, it's basically just about salvation coming belong to the Lord. And through Him, and only by Him, and through Jesus Christ, that we have this salvation. Doesn't matter how we come to in our mind, whether we should go for laws and regulations or just by grace, we must understand and accept this truth, the only one through the way that salvation belongs to the Lord. Eh? I believe from people who listen to chapter 1 to 11, they should have a clarification and also to accept, okay, well, this is a way that we should kind of accept the one that came back from Jerusalem, because after expel or other places, they went back to Rome, the Jews, and then now they should accept the Gentile. The Gentile also should accept the Jews. So by now, how? It's by love. It's the way we live out our life that will continue to use what we call practical ways to bring everyone together. It's no point and also meaningless for us just to say, I love you, I love you, I love you, and share peace without really coming with action. We must put in some practical ways there. For what Paul had put in chapter 12 to chapter 16, you can see God, I mean, Paul is kind of to re-emphasize again of what Jesus is teaching on the Sermon on the Mount. You put them all together in comparison, you'll be to find out the long list of it, what Jesus had told and taught the disciple in the Sermon of the Mount from Matthew chapter 5 to 7 is very similar. Another word is that Paul, it doesn't come up with some new practical way, basically just what Jesus had taught them before. And obviously for the Jews, they should understand this because they are very close to that, what Jesus had taught them, the Sermon of the Mount. So here, as we look at Romans chapter 12, it should be quite easy to understand because it's quite direct. You should do this, you shouldn't do this. The do's and the don'ts that listed out by Paul, but it's the way that our decision to make it happen. The word of the Lord is there since day one. It's time for us to really come to a point again to make that resolution and make that decision, hey, this is what we should do. If we really want to unite the church together and live in the new life that in Christ, this is what we should do. So in chapter 12, with this title, Overcoming Evil with Good, chapter 12 is not just about overcoming evil with good. You have four sections actually. If you break it down, the first one is all about our relationship with certain group of people and God. Verse 1, verse 2, we are so familiar with it. Offer yourself, do not conform to the pattern of the world, things like that, stuff like that, become living sacrifice, pleasing to God. Okay? That is about our relationship with God. Verse 3 to verse 8 is about our relationship with ourselves. How we should discover and also use of the gift that Lord has deposited to us to serve in this body of Christ. Then verse 9 to verse 16 is about our relationship with others. That's why that love come in. You know, quite similar with 1 Corinthians chapter 12, 13 and 14. 12 and 14 is about gift, how you use the gift. Chapter 13, Paul inserted in. He said, this is the way. The only way for us to exercise all this gift is true love. So here, verse 9 to verse 16, immediately after verse 3 to verse 8 about discovering our gift to serve in the body of Christ, we must use love. Verse 9 to verse 16. Then the last section is at 17 to 21, which I have changed it in your daily living water. We're supposed to read from verse 9 to verse 21. But I discovered if I put that together, it will become a two very big topic for us to talk about. It will be two sermons. So I decided to cut it, to narrow down. You should use the word to cut it, to narrow down to verse 14 to verse 21. It's about our relationship with enemies. Talk about enemies. How many enemies do you have? Just a few seconds to count. Some of us probably not enough by using our 10 fingers. Oh, can I use my toes? It's just too many. Or we will say, which one? You don't really, we cannot come across with that, I'm a holy people, I'm a Christian, I shouldn't have enemies. We do. But we also need to ask, who is your enemies? Why you make them, or you define them as enemy? As a normal person, he or she will not come to you to say to you, I'm your enemy. From today onward, I will be your enemy. None of the people will do that. If people do that, they are kind of abnormal. They are not normal. So normally, who is the one that considered as our enemy? Who make them the enemy? It's us. We are the one who define them as our enemy. If they steal our banana, we say they're our enemy. If they play football, unfair, then we say it's our enemy. Badminton, our an opponent. Another gentle word to say opponent basically is the enemy. Sometimes we even make the dog also our enemy. If the dogs eat our thing or destroy our plant, we make them an enemy. It's the way we make them, we define them, it also decide on our actions on them. Like cockroach, also our enemy. It depends on you how you kill that cockroach. Some people kill cockroach, they'll say, that's all. Some people, that is enemy. The cockroach didn't hurt you. Why you treat the cockroach like that? Sometimes we also make the mic our enemy. No? When the mic is not sound, we try and beat the mic. Hello? Don't beat the mic. The mic didn't hurt you. Why you hurt the mic? Unknowingly or knowingly, we make many people and many things become our enemy. If we live a life like that, then we are in trouble. No people can live a long and peaceful life with a lot of enemies in their life. With enemies, sometimes we get a lot of headache, we think away, we spend so much time, just like Saul, spending all his energy and time and even resources to go and hunt down David. Think about it. Paul just used that time to think about how to really go and destroy and fight against the Philistine, which is the real enemy. He could have triumphed over many victories. But instead of doing so, he spent all his time just to hunt down David, which is like harmless to him. But that is our life. Of course, Jesus had warned us about enemies in our ministry. Won't be surprised that you will attract opposition because of the work of the ministry. Paul also mentioned that Paul and Peter had experienced so many oppositions, so many enemies in their life because of the work. That is okay. Even Jesus warned, he said, the worst it will be the not opposition coming from our own household. Matthew chapter 10, verse 36. Father against son against father, a sibling against sibling, and so on. That is going to happen. But unfortunately, there are believers whereby we have enemies because we are lack of love and patience. not because of the faithfulness of us in doing or witnessing for Christ. If we do that, then you will see the difference between what mentioned in Galatians chapter 5:11, the offense of the cross. Because of the work of the cross, we attract offense and opposition. Enemies will rise up to against us because of the work of the cross. That is okay. There's a difference between those people and what we call being an offense Christian. I mean, we our behavior, because our wrongdoing, it's just a way of life. I'm not quite sure, do you have friends like that or not? I have friends like that. I have members also like that. Not here, lah. Okay? I have members like that also. So, yeah, they just like to call for fight. They just want to stir up dissension. They just want to stir up issue. Yeah, no, this their life. So, as we look at the reality of it, what are we going to do about it? It really depends on us. Because our relationship with God, with ourselves, with others, and with our enemies does matter. Okay? So let's ask the Lord to help us to really restore and also mend that broken relationship. Because the way we handle it, we handle it wrongly. Amen? So four things here that I want to bring out from verse 14 to verse 21. For all that four resounding negative imperative Paul had mentioned, do not. And put together, of course, the other do not as well, but most of the time Paul also asks us, do this. Okay? So I bring it up together with this relation between this do not, four things. First one, do not curse. Romans chapter 12, verse 14, bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Don't curse. People you hear, when they curse, they will curse your ancestor. They will curse your descendants as well. It curses like you until your 18th generation. Mean 18th generation after you are not gonna suffer under that curse. Sometimes it's so mean, sometimes it's so cruel. Looking at people, how people curse them. The more they fight, the longer of the fight, you see the more cursing coming out from there. But if you look at Luke, another version of the Sermon on the Mount, chapter 6, verse 27, Jesus said, but I tell you who hear me, love your enemy, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who mistreat you. Just to forgive them is all considered quite difficult. Do good for them and bless them and even pray for them. I'm not quite sure how you're going to handle this. The first time I hear this from my nurture class before my preparation for baptism, I say, oh. Because in our secondary school, our teenager, a lot of bad enemies, one. Okay? We just treat everyone like enemies. And then we are so, some call, like, I'm the prefect of the church, I'm the school. And then quite outstanding in the sense, because in like football, basketball, we are always there. And our class also, we are the top among, we the best of the best, things like that. So you always attract a lot of opposition, people jealous about us and so on. We just take it all in. And now my nurture class teacher, using this word, he say, hey, you just kind of bless them and pray for them. I say, I pray for my enemy. I wish that they will go to. Pray for them. It's not my obligation. It's not my job. They are my enemy. How am I going to pray for them? Even when I pray for them, it will not stay long. I was so reluctant to say, pray, Lord, pray to heal them. It's really hard. It's really hard. Not to curse, but to bless them. So my nurture class teacher taught me, he said, now, next time when people curse you, what you do, you should say, God bless you, and smile. Well, that's quite difficult. I think you've got to listen, because those times are baptism class, very strict one. You don't do it, you cannot go for baptism. Oh, okay. All right. For the sake of baptism, I got to do it. So in the school, my friends cursed me. I was just, God bless you. My teacher also, one of my teachers is very good in this cursing one. Eh? You beat up. Sorry, I used the word quite rough. Right? You beat up. Taguna. Pagu kau jual Coca-Cola di bus stop. Well, we are the best of the best, okay? Not just to be proud, but then we are the best. You will curse them and curse them. Something like that. It's almost like the Cantonese. So, yeah. Second week, sorry. It's not like a Cantonese. Last week I talked, was it last week or the week before? I talked about Hong Kong people. Then people say, hey, not Hong Kong people got, yeah, say generally, not that one. I should use the waitress on me. So Cantonese also, Hakka, yeah, I just got to admit, Hakka also. Quite bad, especially we curse our own children. It's like compare our son to the cha siu. How can you compare your son with the cha siu one? So that's the thing. So I learned, God bless you. When my teacher scold me and curse me, God bless you. And just sometimes they go, bukan saja piadab, gila, God bless you. So my friend also said, hey, what happened to you? Yeah, this is, I need to practice what I was asked to do. Because when Paul put this, do not curse, all this do not here, it's not a choice. It's not an option for us. Let me think about it. No. Just like what Jesus said, actually, it just follow. There's an instruction here. Do not. So Matthew chapter 5, the original, that complete version, so-called, the Sermon of the Mount, in verse 44, but I tell you, love your enemy and pray for those who persecute you. Yeah. Because by doing so, somehow you will stop that cursing. Seriously. You will stop that progress of the cursing. Once you stop that, you see, you can avoid a lot of issues. And even you can live in peace, because you will not think about it. You will not so take or paying attention to it. Like people curse you, it's true or not? I'm like that. I'm like that one. Yeah. When you say me, I'm ugly. Is it true? I'm ugly or not? Then you will be bound yourself with that, because people say you something bad about you. By doing so, to bless them and pray for them, you stop the things immediately. Okay? Second, do not repay anyone evil for evil. Verse 17 to 18, do not repay anyone evil for evil. So, right after this, you see, if you do that paragraph thing together, which I already know, we learned it in the leaders' briefing, you will see 17 and 18 is the same. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. How? There are two things Paul mentioned. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. Another version of it is from J.B. Philip. See that your public behavior is about criticism. If I do good, why Paul asked me to be careful? Yet last night, we have a very good illustration from one of the leaders. He said, Canon, just like we put those sticker, so-called godly Christian sticker, God love you and so on, in our car. It's a good thing, but we want to bless somebody, it's a good thing. But we need to be very careful. The moment we put it up there, then if, just in case, you know, the way you drive the car makes other driver angry or so on, then they will criticize us. You get what I mean? Just like today, actually 2 weeks ago, I tried out. I just tried to find out, is it anyone who going to criticize me or not by wearing black mask? Because when we started it, we all choose either white or those plain color or blue, no? Whether I can wear black mask or not and wearing my robe. Of course, last 2 weeks ago when I tried it, I wearing jacket. So nobody really realized it. So today I'm going to try it again. Just in case people will criticize you. Hey, Reverend Kenneth, why you use black mask? It's not suitable. Ah, okay. That is below public criticism. I wear this because this is 4-ply. My blue one is 3-ply. So it's not because I choose, like, you know, things like that, but I just tried it out. But because of I do so-called, for me, it's good things. For me, ma, protection. Ma. But it's below public, what we call behavior. This is below the criticism. Then I don't do it. It's just in case, right after this, a lot of messages come in. Canon, you shouldn't use black mask. Then next week, you will not see me wearing it. Because it's still below public criticism. Huh? Just the last time we wear black shirt. The woman teenager wear, young people wear black shirt, hey, gangster. Hey, this is, no, young people, don't wear black. Black is something, you know, evil, something naughty, you know. But very soon after that, you see, slowly, youth camp, old black t-shirt. Today you wear black, nothing wrong with it. 20 years ago, they say 20 years, I thought 10 years ago. 20 years ago, when we dye our hair, we cannot even get into the worship team. Yesterday, one leader asked me, how about those, Reverend, how about those white hair? And then dye our hair to black. Yeah, 20 years ago, cannot. You dye your hair, you cannot even get into worship team, not even backup or worship musician. But nowadays, you see some our musicians dye from to become gray and even mixed color. Some little bit of gray, little bit of green color. And a leading song. Now nobody will talk about it. I won't be surprised after our generation pass, 20 years from now, tattoo will be acceptable in the church. Now you're seeing it, some other Western churches, their pastors are wearing tattoo, not because they tattoo themselves before, because Christian, they just tattoo it because it's acceptable in their Christian community, but not here yet, not here. You will not see me tattoo one. I will not do it. I will be very careful to do what is good or what is right in the eyes of everybody. I hope you understand it. It's not so much like, oh, yeah, everybody is doing it, nothing wrong with it, ma. It's not heaven and hell. So I go, no, Paul say, hey, be careful. It seems like if we do it wrongly, it's just like we are repaying anyone evil for evil. For that context. No? So another thing is that Paul suggests, he said, it is possible as far as you, there's two initiatives here, it is possible as far as, depend on who, say with me together, depend on me, not say you. Sometimes you say, depend on you. Depend on you. Say with me together, depend on me. Live at peace with everybody. Amen. It really depends on us. So that, coming back to that, do be careful to do what is right in everyone's eyes of the body. It depends on us. Can we choose not to wear if the public say no? Like I said just now, if somebody, a lot of messages come in, hey, you shouldn't wear black, so then next week I will not do it. Not because I'm fear, but because publicly that I'm below that criticism. So I will not wear it. I will not wear it. It depends on me. If I still want to wear it, how? The consequences that I have to bear on myself because I decide to do that. All right? So this is what Paul says. Don't repay anyone evil for evil. Huh? And Matthew chapter 5, what Jesus said is that you have heard that it was said for an eye for an eye, tooth for tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If someone strikes you on the right cheek, turn to him the other side. That I illustrated this before. You know? Normally, when people strike you from the right hand, it will hit your left cheek. Hitting your right cheek is mean I'm going to do like this. Nobody will slap people like this one. So what they did is that they will slap you from the back of your hand. That is an insult. That is an insult. Not just hurting you. It's insulting you. So when people do that, give them another chip. Let them complete it, because they will do it anyway. But we shouldn't fight back. Don't, because those, like you see kids fight, they punch you one time, they punch you twice. Then another, they will pay back 4, then 8, 16, 32, 64, 128, and 254, and 254, then 516, then 1028. Hey, where are you going to the end? Nothing. So stop it. So verse 9, Matthew chapter 5, verse 9, the Beatitude, one of those, he said, blessed are the peacemaker, for they will be called the Son of God. Be a peacemaker. Instead of we try to find ways to repay some evil with evil. It's no payback time. It's only peacemaking time. But many of us choose not. Because today you go and do peacemaker for Silao. You don't do people probably punch you also. When people fight, better don't cut you, better don't disturb them. You go there and they'll punch you. Why you nothing to do with you, go away. So we as a community, we choose to be silenced. It's not easy, I know. Because the moment we do it, it will cost us something. But here is our life. Because by doing so, you will replace the evil plan in you. As we seek to be the peacemaker, we will not get ourselves involved in doing something evil. Amen? Mark chapter 9, verse 50. Salt is good, but it loses its saltiness. How can you make it salty again? Have salt in yourself. Be at peace with each other. Salt will lose its saltiness, because last time salt is not like us, the refined kind of salt. They come with the kind of a material, a rock. So sometimes they got to lick it. Yeah? Sometimes they got to extract it by themselves. When you see the things gone, actually it's still inside, but then you cannot reach that saltiness. There's no saltiness of it. They will throw it outside. Throw it outside, people will trample upon it, or they'll pick it up and throw it to the dung heap, the dump yard. So as we become salt bring all favor together. With a little touch of salt, you bring the favor of your dish coming together. Amen? Eh? So that is our position, our identity, our duty as a salt of this world. Eh? So instead of paying anyone evil for evil, let us make peace and be a peacemaker. Third, do not take revenge. Some more. At first you ask to bless, ask not to repay. Now Paul says, do not take revenge, my friend. But leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it's mine to avenge, I will repay, say the Lord. On the contrary, if you're angry, he's hungry, feed him. He's thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing so, you'll heap burning coal on his head. If we start to defend for ourselves, then the Lord cannot defend for us. It's just like a courtroom. If we choose to defend on ourselves, then no lawyer can help us. No one can come in, because you have dropped that privilege. Today we have the privilege for letting God to help us to avenge. A few days ago, if you follow the daily devotion, I talk about righteousness. What righteousness? You seek our own righteousness, there are no ends. Because sometime our righteousness will get on increasing. Today it might be like this, tomorrow I increase it a little bit. The day after tomorrow, I increase it a little bit. So every time we will see people will not meet our standard. That's why we get angry, we get to what we call like even a point of revenge. But when you seek God's righteousness, there's always an ending there. The moment you put yourself there, you will see, and when you ask God, what is your righteousness? When God put that standard in, hey, you remember? Why you look at others' eyes, the sawdust on other, you don't see the plank in your own eye. yamchaya. I listened to one pastor mention yamchaya. I remember until today yamchaya. Wow, you know, you look at people's shoulder, so little bit, but you cannot see your own yamchaya in your eye. What righteousness? So Paul say, hey, don't do that. Leave room for God's wrath. I shared with you before that story. One of the uncle of the family was killed. They trying to get both the police and some of the the secret society, no, the mafia, not mafia lah. I mean the gangster, whatever. So they want to use the connection with the black and the white to help them to get revenge on this murderer, the robber. But in the funeral service, I just used this words. I said, leave room for God's wrath. Let God avenge. You don't do it. Thank God, after the funeral service, the taiko came in. That's it. I just get ready. I even asked the staff, just get ready. Because they're going to say something, going to piss off them. They came over and say, Reverend, you're right. I will listen to you. I listen to what you say. I leave room for God. He's not a kind of faithful, kind of regular Christian. But then he's willing to listen to them. And soon enough, less than a week, I think, the murderer was caught by the police and put into the justice. Instead of we ourselves go and do it, just like movie. Somebody kill your wife, then you kill the whole village. Then the village kill your son, then the son, your grandson kill another. Never ending one. So that's why emperor, Chinese emperor, very cruel. When they want to kill somebody, they kill the whole nine gao zhok mean the relative. Even your ama, your maid belong to your family. Oh, going to sentence to death. So he will make sure there are no descendants alive and revenge on the emperor. So this is the thing. For us, we just doing the opposite. If the enemy is hungry, feed him. Thirsty, give him something to drink. By doing so, you are heaping burning coal on his head. Burning coal always talk about repentance, forgiveness. There's some country, Africa, some of the Middle East country, they still have this, what we call, if you want to go for a penitence, a true repentance, it's like you need to hold a bowl of burning coal on your head to walk publicly. To let people know that you are truly repent from your wrongdoing. Yeah, it's still happening. Okay, so I think that is an influence here. To saying that, to let that person to feel like, it's the one that I will, so shameful because I do this for you. So do not take revenge. Let God do it. Let God do it in order for us to see God can save that person. If we are the one who do it, probably we will hurt him and destroy or even kill that person. To at that extent. When God do it, God will have his way. God will decide. Amen. Let God vindicate for whatever you think is unfair in your company, in your school, even in your house, or in the church. Yeah, we don't need to take revenge for ourselves. Deuteronomy chapter 32, it is mine to avenge. I will repay to due time. Their foot will sleep. Their day is disaster is near, and their doom rushes upon them. Chinese saying, 恶有恶报,不是不报,只是时辰未到. The evil will be repaid. It's not that no avenge, but then it's just about timing. Yeah? But surely they will get it. By who? By God. Not us. Okay? Not us. So Luke chapter 6, verse 35 to verse 36, by love your enemy, to do good to them, and lend to them without expecting to get something, anything back. Then your reward will be great, and you will be sons and of the Most High, because he's the kind of the ungrateful and wicked. Be merciful, just as your Father is merciful. That's a key word there. Be merciful, just as your Father is merciful. Amen. So last, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Eh? Because if you don't do good, then evil will come in. then we will do things very evilly, very wickedly. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 23, when they heard their insult at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threat. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. He surrendered to God. Amen. So James chapter 4, verse 7, submit yourself then to God. Resist the devil, then he will flee from you. It is true. I do not know how to explain to you theologically or biblically, but it did happen to me. When we go higher the position, somehow, whether in the church or outside, they're saying in the Chinese, su da zao feng, mean the bigger your tree, that you take more wind in. So that is unavoidable. Okay? Those of you who are working outside, you know, the higher you go, you attract more oppositions than ever before. So here, what I experienced is that just remember to do good to them. By doing so, you resist the devil, because the devil will kind of flee from you. When they come to you, they tempt you, but you are, instead of doing evil, he wants you to do evil. He wants you to pay back evil to evil. But you choose to do good. After some time, somehow the devil just left me. It's no fun. This guy will not fall into temptation. This guy will always do good one. The more I do it on him, then he will be have more credit and glory, because he do good to the evil. He will receive more praise from people and from God. Hey, 算了吧, Chinese saying. Hey, forget about it and look for someone else. Seriously. Until such time, I had kind of cultivate, kind of take kind of discipline in me. I remember last time when I play football, you know, playing football, sometimes you come for competition. Those are semi-legal competition, semi-official competition, mean you choose your own. No referee, okay, you become referee. No? And how much more that referee from the opponent, and then they're winning. Eh? Their winning goal, their goal come from, because offside, the referee say no offside. Wow, it's really get to me. There are a couple of times that I really burst into, like, even physically. I track down that person until I can hurt him or tackle that person. Yeah, seriously, that me. Yeah, I mean, that was me. I remember one time, because of the member, was a foul on this guy, and then referee didn't do anything at all, and we are losing. Just in front of me, I stood up, like, you know, in the name of the pastor of this member. I stood up and I just want to get into a fight already. Hey, how can you do that? I didn't really get into it. And the whole thing, because the pastor stood up, that's it, license to fight. All the members also, wow, because like pastor started it, what's it going? And I almost really get into a fight. After that, I was so regret and bearing a very bad testimony in public among those what we call non-Christian. Yeah, I decided to stop. I decided to stop playing football for quite some time and started to cultivate that, just letting good, there no evil. Because I stopped it, I resist that, not giving him any opportunity to tempt me or do it to me. After some time, it just left. It was a couple of years later, I started playing football again by training some of the young people in the church. Then I discovered there no more. I just so calm. Even they rule things like not unfairly, I say, just, oh, it's okay, huh? We just get it back. We just get it back. The moment they score because of offside, referee didn't blow, I say, it's okay, it's okay, we get it back. It's okay, just leave it. We get it back. Eh? Yeah, it's just gone. No? So that's something we can cultivate. We can discipline ourselves to do it. So at the end, I want to give you some suggestions for us to start this practice here, this spiritual discipline. First, Matthew chapter 6, verse 14 to verse 15. For if you For if you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their sin, your Father will not forgive your sin. It's like not just forgive and forget, it's about like accepting that person. We cannot forgive one person because we cannot accept their way, their lifestyle. By forgiving them, we are accepting them by looking at how God looked at them. God wants everyone to be saved. God will forgive even the worst sinner. That's why He sent His Son Jesus Christ to us. So by doing so, learn how to accept people, no matter how mean they are in your surrounding. Learn how to accept them. Amen. Matthew chapter 18, verse 21 to verse 22. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother when he sinned against me? Up to seven times? It's kind of complete. Is it seven times enough or not? Jesus answered, I tell you, not seven times, it's 77 times, 490 times. If you need 490 times to forgive somebody, is something wrong with you? Also something wrong with that person. Mean that person keep on coming back 490 times. Both of you have problem. We need help. We need help. But it's always on our side. Always on our way. It depends on us. Even up to 77 times. If you need that 419 times, Jesus said, you still need to forgive. It's another way. Is that it's there. It's just a reality. They will not go until Jesus comes again. It will be there until either He leaves you or you leave them. As long as you are there, like sibling among siblings, you're still going to see each other the next morning. That's why people say husband and wife fight. You fight at the head of the bed, you will end up at the tail of the bed. 从头打到从尾和吗? Where got 隔夜仇? Mean there's no leftover, what they call? Anger? Yeah, level of hatred. There's no level one. The morning, the next morning, you wake up, you still need to see each other. You're still living under the same roof. We're still living under, still worshiping and serving and now living under this same church. Why we need to do that? So, yeah, learn to accept, learn to forgive. Luke chapter 23. Verse 34, Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. Even you come to a point about like death, like Jesus Christ on the cross, He said, forgive them. Still choose to forgive them. What Paul say? To bless, to do good, seek peace, and serve or even try to convert your enemy. Okay? So my own suggestion to you, one more and one last. Drop it before it's happened. This is what I learned in my life. Drop it before it happens. Don't wait until it happens, then learn how to drop it. You drop it before it happens. Mean you choose to drop it, not to hate, not to repay evil by evil. You drop it before it happens. So when it happens, that is something easy to handle. A few months ago, I just met one of those. Yeah. I just met him, and we are going to a same event. I can choose to walk up, and I'm not obligated to say anything or stop by. I can go into the venue on myself first, why I need to. But God says, stop. Wait for him and say hello and greet him. I didn't consider at all. But because God says so. Yeah, I will do it. I will do it. I will not do it reluctantly. I will do it. So wait under a hot sun with my jacket on. So hot. With my collar and so on. So hot. But I do it very willingly and joyfully. I just wait until he gets everything done and walk to me. And say hi. The whole service was, the whole event was so joyful. I don't need to worry Were he going to take photo on me, or were he going to stab me from the back? Were he going to criticize me or whatever? Because I'm not. Just peacefully, joyfully, I enjoy the whole event. Yeah. Drop it before it's happened. Don't keep. There's no point for us to keep. How big is our heart? How big is our emotion? Can take all in. It will not just affect our spiritual life, but it will affect our physical life. High blood, headache, cannot sleep, insomnia, cholesterol. Then your heart will have problem, kidney will have problem. Then when kidney failure, everything will cause problem. Yeah, the doctor looking at me, I don't know. It will cause everything. It just started with one little thing. Yeah. So what's the point? Just drop it. Just drop it. Amen. So Paul warned them, warned the Jews and the Gentile. Hey, come together. We're all under same salvation. We're all under same justification. We're all under going through the same sanctification. Let's do it together. Don't cause other issue. Just journey this together in Christ. We will all gonna be okay. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we ask for your grace to help us to overcome evil with good. We pray, as it is by your grace, don't bring us into the temptations that beyond what we can bear. Help us, O Lord. When that's happened, help us to trust and depend on you solely. Father, we commit ourselves into your hand. Pray that the Lord, you will restore our relationship, not just with you, God, but with others and even to our enemies. Father, we commit all this. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, I invite you to all stand and let us recite the Nicene Creed to reaffirm our faith. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, one in being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered, died, and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in fulfillment of the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated, brother and sister. Okay, I want to welcome all of us to be here and worship together, both here, where some of us are here on site and also online. And I especially want to extend our welcome to newcomers that you're worshiping with us for the first time. Then I want to encourage you to continue to join us and find out more from our church Facebook and also our church website. If you do have some inquirement or even for prayer requests, please do not hesitate to call some of the leaders and even to contact the church, to the pastor and some of the clergy as well. All right. So I want to highlight to you some of the announcements from the bulletin, which we can see. I want to give thanks to the Lord for the online mid-autumn celebration. So far, we haven't had the statistic. We are still waiting for two of our groups from English zone. Most likely, they're going to do it this week. But for the Chinese zone, they have the statistic that listed down here. They have invited 139 people all together attended the celebration online, and are 28 newcomers. Yeah? And also for the youth, there are 34 people, have three newcomers. I want to praise the Lord. This is the first ever online mid-autumn celebration. In the midst of all this, I pray that we reach out to them, not just sending them greetings of the mooncake and eating the mooncake, but truly using this by showing them the true light in their life. We want to continue to pray for follow-up so that we can reach out to them, invite them to the DD group, or even to worship with us in the church. Obviously, we're going to prepare them. When the church resume, we're going to invite them come to the church to worship together. Amen? Now, for our church weekly events or activities, surely tomorrow night, our leaders' training will resume. That remember, those are there. That are your homework, your Bible memory verses. And also, the online prayer meeting, we're going to resume. It is coming Tuesday that we're back here at 8 o'clock online. So I want to strongly encourage all of us to attend this prayer meeting. It's very important for us to pray. Now we see things are getting better. Sometimes they're getting worse and better. It's like a roller coaster. We need to pray that it's not just asking God to take things away, but helping us by His grace that we have enough strength, that His grace is sufficient for us to really handle and also overcome the present situation. Amen? All right? So the rest of the announcement, please take note from the bulletin. Please continue to remember some of the members who was affected because of the recent flood, especially from the BM side. I think some of the Chinese and also English congregation also was seriously affected by it. Let's all pray that the Lord will give them strength and also courage to them and to comfort them for some of the damages, company, even factory, or even houses. So want to pray and remember them in prayer. And of course, if you have a chance to extend your help to them, please do so. With this limitation of SOP, sometimes we cannot do that as a church here, but we can do it under what we call the Love Your Neighbor Project. Just extend your help to them as well. Amen? Okay? So let's all pray together.
We now enter into the time of intercession. Let us just quieten down our hearts and let us join our hearts in prayer. This morning in thanksgiving, we want to lift up the mighty name of our Lord, for great is His name, our rock, our fortress, our King, our Redeemer, the first and the last. There is no other gods besides Him. For He assures us and said in Isaiah 44:8, "Do not tremble, do not be afraid. Did I not proclaim this and foretell it long ago? You are my witnesses. Is there any God besides me? No, there is no other rock. I know not one." Father God, grant us boldness and passion to unswervingly be your witnesses, O Lord, in such challenging times as this. Let our faith rise up with divine knowledge and understanding. For our church, we pray for the young adult ministries in the BM, Chinese and English congregations. Despite uncertain circumstances in their respective workplace and in the world, Lord, we pray that you will instill in them hope and a better future in the days ahead, and that they may know the direction and purpose of their lives. Let disheartened hearts be encouraged. In despair, let there be hope. In darkness, let there be light. We give thanks and pray for the ongoing GS Kids Holiday Club from the 17th to the 19th of September. Let your word be engraved in their young minds, O Lord, and let their spiritual lives be nurtured and nourished. Anoint Reverend Tan Chok Kee and his team as they creatively and passionately share the mission of love to them. For our diocese, we remember the BM Prayer Conference on the 5th and 6th of November, and we pray for the speakers, Archbishop Datu Melta Tyers, Dean Musa Ambai, Canon Kenneth Tien, Reverend Samuel Sampi, and Pastor Florence Matthew. Anoint their hearts and minds with revelations from up on high, O Lord, with your messages for a time such as this. Stir up in the intercessors a new level of faith that will intercede for the prevailing situation. For our nation, we pray for the security of the nation and more especially to those in charge of the armed forces and those responsible for peace and security in the nation in the midst of trying times. Let there be vigilance, alertness, and strength for all those serving in this all-important task of keeping the nation and its people safe. For our state, we pray for protection and safety. For the school children, when they return to school in October, may all SOP be diligently and reverently observed to give assurance to the parents who are hesitant to send their children back to school. Let the confidence of the parents be restored by the responsible efforts of school authorities to exercise exceptional care and caution in the new norm for its students. O Lord, for all this we ask and pray in the most precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Heavenly Father, you have promised to hear what we ask in the name of your Son. Accept and fulfill our petitions, we pray, not as we ask in our ignorance, nor as we deserve in our sinfulness, but as you know and love us in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ said. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first commandment. The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other greater commandment greater than these. Together, Lord, have mercy upon us, and write these laws in our hearts, we beseech you. Continue to pray. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us therefore confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all men. The confession together. Merciful God, our Heavenly Father, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you, against our fellow men, in thought, word, and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We repent and are truly sorry for our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you, and deliver you from all sins. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you for his service by the power of the Holy Spirit, and keep you in eternal life. Amen. I invite you all to stand. Now that we have been put right with God through faith in Jesus Christ, we have peace with God, so we must make peace with one another in the body of Christ. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Brothers and sisters, let us greet each other with the peace. Peace be with you. Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is not only right, it is our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give you thanks and praise, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And now we give you thanks because you have revealed your glory as the glory of your Son and of the Holy Spirit. Three persons equal in majesty, undivided in splendor, yet one Lord, one God, ever to be worshipped and adored. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Please be seated. All glory to you, our Heavenly Father, for in your tender mercy, you give your only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption. He made there a full atonement for the sins of the whole world, offering once for all his one sacrifice of himself. He instituted and in his holy gospel commanded us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until he comes again. Yours, merciful Father, we humbly pray and grant that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we who receive these gifts of bread and wine, according to your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ's holy institution, and remembrance of his death and suffering, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood, who, in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Together we proclaim, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Blessed are those who are invited to the feast of the Lamb. The gifts of God for the people of God, draw near with faith and humbly receive this bread and wine in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ keep you in eternal life. Amen. The Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Do not bring us in time of trial, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Together. Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. Thank you that you have fed us with spiritual food and sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Amen. I invite you to stand to receive God's blessing. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Brothers and sisters, go in peace and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen.
Thank you.
service has ended. Have a blessed week ahead. And we'll see you back on Sunday next. Amen.